Psychedelic medicines have been right by our side as allies on this journey for quite some time. What is there that they can help us learn about ourselves and reality? What is required for us to develop this relationship in an intelligent way as a society? This is Skull Babylon, and you're about to listen to episode 50 of Paradigm Shift Radio, in which we welcomed on Oliver Huckenhall, the director of the influential and educational film Neurons to Nirvana, Understanding Psychedelic Medicines. The film itself is another important tool for us to be able to bring these important conversations into mainstream circles and beyond. While the Kickstarter page is still up, please contribute to the project and share it with your friends as part of the co-creator of this reality in which psychedelics are more openly discussed and understood within societal context. The conversation was an insightful one with plenty of avenues covered. Reminder that we here at Paradigm Shift Radio are not here to advocate the use of psychedelics, but rather here to promote the discussion of the topic. Check out the movie at facebook.com/neuronstonirvana and contribute in whatever way you can. Even simple shares make a big difference. Be sure to also like Paradigm Shift Radio on Facebook and check out more at paradigmshiftcentral.com. Unfortunately, Blog Talk Radio glitched out following the group meditation, but stick around to the end for an extra bonus Paradigm Shift Radio surprise. Keep your mind open, listen to understand, and allow your perceptions to expand. Enjoy the show. Part of what psychedelics do is they decondition you from culture values. This is what makes it such a political hot potato, since all culture is kind of a con game, and the most dangerous candy you can hand out is one which causes people to start questioning the rules of the game. This is Skull Babylon, and you're tuned into the 50th episode of Paradigm Shift Radio. Thank you, everyone, for tuning in for this awesome episode that we got lined up ahead of us tonight. We're going to be having on Oliver, who is the director of the movie Neuron to Nirvana, and it's a movie about understanding psychedelic medicines, which is the topic of tonight's show, and we're going to be helping them raise some money tonight by bringing in some discussion as to what this film is about, and by encouraging you to go to the GoFundMe page, the Kickstarter page, and you can find a link for that through the links in the Blog Talk Radio on your right hand side of the chat, just above the chat. And make sure you right click and open that in a new tab so you don't accidentally move yourself away from the show, so you don't miss any of the awesome content. But we'll be getting more into that in a bit. Just for those of you who perhaps have not tuned into Paradigm Shift Radio, let me just introduce myself, what Paradigm Shift Radio is about, and a little bit of the latest in terms of Paradigm Shift news and what's been happening and more stuff that you guys can get yourself involved with in. So my name is Brendan, aka Skull Babylon, aka Wolf Shield. And obviously, like I said, we've been doing 50 episodes. Like, that is a huge milestone, bicentennial. We've been doing this literally for almost a year. We started at the end of June in 2012, and it's been amazing to see where things have evolved since then. And I just want to give a huge amount of gratitude to everybody who has been involved with that. And for those of you, like I said, who may not be familiar with what Paradigm Shift is, first of all, ParadigmShiftCentral.com is the website that you want to check out. Go to that website, and you'll see that Paradigm Shift Central is more than just a radio show. It is a hub for a global network of Paradigm Shift communities all across the world that are working in cooperation and collaboration to be able to bring new consciousness into this world by encouraging both the creation of digital communities such as Facebook pages, as well as physical communities that have consistent and regular meetings that get people out of their houses and into a circle of discussion where they can practice having conversations about the things that they don't usually get a chance to talk about. Such a topic is an example of what we're talking about tonight, is the topic relating to psychedelic medicine. So in terms of the Paradigm Shifty news, let me just remind those of you who maybe have not heard yet. I myself am a filmmaker, and I've been doing a lot of the media stuff. I went for school for film, and you can check out my work at youtube.com/skullbabylon. And in particular, up there, you'll see a trailer for a film of my own, Journey to Lucidity, which is getting awesome reviews. It hasn't officially been released yet, but it will be getting publicly released soon, and publicly released to those of you who contribute at the GoFundMe page. So no different from purchasing a ticket to actually watch a movie. And I can say a lot about how awesome the film is, but I don't want to distract what the topic of tonight's topic is, because if you only have $10 in your wallet right now, don't worry about spending it on me. Like, I want this to go towards the Neurons to Nirvana film, because they are working with a deadline in terms of their Kickstarter, and that ends in about 7 days from now, give or take. So guys, we really need to make sure that we put in that extra effort. And this is really just another opportunity for us as a community to really step up and say, this is what we support. This is what we are working together to help create, to help bring into this world, to help educate, to help create like a new like generation of like thought patterns and ideas that are evidently going to help like accelerate the collective evolution of mankind. So in terms of other news, I just want to say that today was a super busy day in terms of shifting paradigms. For myself here in Paradigm Shift London, facebook.com/paradigmshiftlondon, we were involved with the Our Streets Day Festival. It's all previously known as the Car Free Day Festival. And basically they opened up a street downtown and it was really awesome. They had a whole bunch of different booths set up and we had a Paradigm Shift booth and we were handing out buttons there, consciousness shifting buttons. So buttons that have these really cool artistic designs like sacred geometry and fractals and like Alex Gray type art on them that will draw people in. And then on the sides of the buttons, they have the website for paradigmshiftcentral.com as well as the radio and facebook.com/paradigmshiftradio. If you have not checked out that, please do. And of course, you can check out all the past episodes of Paradigm Shift Radio at paradigmshiftcentral.com/PSR. But it was awesome today because I think today it was really a milestone in a multitude of ways. I mean, for the fact that this radio show synchronistically lined up with the Car Free Day Festival, because when I first did the Car Free Day Festival a year ago, we made a video for it. And in that video, it was called The Shift Is You. And I was really encouraging people, like, you know, this is what we're doing here in London. We're, like, going out and we're connecting with people in our community. We're creating that open door. We're inviting people to get involved. We're using synchronicity. We're using the tools at our disposal. And it's happening. You know, if you build it, they will come. People are coming together. We are, like, the light guardians. We are holding up that light and people are being attracted to it. And it really is making a difference, a very real difference in people's lives. And from where we were a year ago to where we are now, the paradigm shift community has grown so much. It is literally close to like 60 or 70 communities, each one varying in terms of activity across the entire globe. And obviously you can check that out at the website, but that is something that we want to be able to take even further. So just this last bit of news that I just want to invite you guys to get involved with, and before we bring on Oliver, is the fact that we are here as a community to be able to help each other. So if you're thinking about starting up a paradigm shift community in your area, now is the perfect time to do it because we are really, really bringing things together. And in particular, what we've created most recently, just since the last show actually, is a specific group for the paradigm shift community admins. And what we're doing with that group is we're communicating with each other. We're saying, you know, this is where I'm associated. Like, this is a community I'm associated with. This is where I live. Here are the challenges I'm facing. Let's work as a team to approach these challenges. And we have Google Hangouts every Sunday right now is where we're scheduling them. So if you want to get involved with that for tomorrow, please go to paradigmshiftcentral.com, scroll down just a little bit, and right underneath just one of the top images, you'll see a link to the Paradigm Shift Community Admin Group. And please get involved with that because we do have the tools, we do have the technology, we have everything we need within arm's reach to be able to create the expanding Paradigm Shift Network. And wherever you are, we want you to get involved with it. So when I say tools, I'm talking things about like poster templates. I'm talking about using the Paradigm Shift Sigil. I'm talking about suggestions and tips in terms of how to organize your meetings and specifically consciousness shifting buttons, which we will be making available for order. And whether you're in a community or not, stay tuned because you will be able to get your hands on those buttons. And go to paradigmshiftcentral.com/buttons if you want to put in a pre-order for that, if you just want to let us know that you're interested. And and t-shirts are on the horizon. That's been an idea for a while. So please get involved with that, guys. We want more people to be involved with the Paradigm Shift community, and it's growing, and it's nature. It's nature in itself. Like, literally, we are spiraling outwards. So huge namaste to everybody who's been involved with that. And again, check out all those links mentioned. But with that said, we are going to bring on Oliver right about now. I got him in the queue, and we're going to take this conversation wherever it needs to go. So we're going to be talking about psychedelics, we're going to be talking about politics, we're going to be talking about what it means to perceive them as a medicine, so to speak. So before I bring Oliver on, I just got to mention that those of you who had seen the promotion for the show, or first of all, I'll just mention for those of you who are listening to the show, please put it out there. The show has not, you know, like the ball's still getting rolling and there's still plenty of awesome content ahead. And we want more people to be able to hear about it. We want more people to be able to find out about the Neuronster Nirvana movie. And yes, happy 11/11 to everyone on the dot right now. And so please, please, please. continue to share this link throughout any pages, throughout any walls, post it on your friends' walls, call up your grandma, tell her to tune in, whatever it takes. Just, you know, the more love, the better. So please do that. Now, like I said, in the promotion, some people might have seen that it was originally scheduled to have Mickey from Elevate Studios. And I'll just plug Mickey real quick, because those of you who listened in the past, around episode 36-ish, we had Mickey on for his involvement with the film Be Brave, a beautiful story about Daniel Northcott. And his life and death, and his inspiration that he brought into this world, and his perspective of unity and oneness. And I'll just plug that real quick, facebook.com/BeBraveMovie. Check that out if you have not heard about it yet. That movie has not been officially released, but that was the past film that we assisted Elevate with in terms of raising funding. So, you know, we worked together and we said, you know, like, let's talk, let's have this conversation, let's let more people find out about this, and let's invite them to contribute to the co-creation of this project. You know, the word donation kind of has some weird connotations to it. So let's invite each other to help co-create. You know, we want to be able to invest our energy in what we want to see brought into this world. And that is a very, very, very powerful thing that we as a digital community have within our lap right now, is to say, this is a project that we want to support. Let's work together and make sure it happens. So abundance for everyone. Absolutely. So Mickey won't be, he may be on the show tonight. There may be a surprise call-in from him, but he's actually busy with some personal stuff. I believe he's marrying some friends of his, and I don't think that's too personal to share. So congratulations to Mickey for having such a valid excuse for missing the show. But we may do a follow-up interview with Mickey maybe later in the week. So there might be like a bonus Paradigm Shift episode later in the week. So stay tuned for that, because I'd love to be able to get Mickey back on the air and involved with this conversation. So we might hear from Mickey tonight, we might not, but in the meantime, we do have Oliver on the show. So we're going to bring on Oliver now. And again, guys, thank you so much for tuning in. Check out the link. So facebook.com/neurons2nirvana is the page, and I'm just going to post a link for that in the live chat. Like that, check out the Kickstarter. There's so many funding pages these days. Check out the Kickstarter page, and I'll post a link for that in the live chat as well, or just run a search on Kickstarter for Neurons in Nirvana and you'll find it. So let's do it, guys. Let's make sure that this film does happen, and let's hear more about it as we continue the conversation here with Oliver. So Oliver, we're going to be bringing you in live from Vancouver, Canada. So Oliver, if you're ready, I'm going to bring you on to Paradigm Shift Radio.
Hi. Do you hear me now?
Yes, you hear me? Oliver. Loud and clear. Perfect.
Okay, great. Awesome. Well, thank you very much for that introduction, and thanks for all of your work. It sounds like you're doing a tremendous amount these days, and it's really great to hear. It's really good to hear about your engagement with this. And I mean, it does seem like the psychedelic spirit, if you will, is turning into or is expanding out through the digital network, and that's great. That's how it should
Absolutely.
Be.
Absolutely. And you know, for both of us being able to have this conversation, it's always interesting to be able to talk with another filmmaker, someone who's involved with using this particular medium to be able to tell a story, to be able to bring something to the surface and bring something to people's attention that will evidently help shift the paradigm and you know, plant those seeds for how they sort of see the world around them. So, Oliver, just to sort of get right to the core of what we're talking about here, please explain to the people what this film is about and also what it is trying to accomplish.
Well, I think it's trying to accomplish a number of things. And one of the central things that it's doing is introducing people to the concept of psychedelics as essential medicines, that they are keys, if you will, to beyond the veil, if you will. They are ways in which we can appreciate our communality, ways in which we can appreciate the synchronicity of our lives. There are ways, in many ways, in which these are used to heal problems concerning post-traumatic stress disorder, depression, all sorts of other psychological issues that people have. And most of us, even younger people, have a lot of stress in their lives, and a lot of we've lived in war cultures we live in times of war, right? And we see these. We see all these terrible things that are happening all around us. And most of us are actually, you know, are traumatized by these experiences. And if we don't heal ourselves, if we don't recover ourselves through either meditation or yoga or medicines, then we will have trouble. And I think that the issue of this film is to present these substances as ways in which we can recover the self.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very good, very good. I'm just getting some feedback. It was a little choppy there, but I don't think that's your problem. We still got the message. I think it's just might be just because I got a couple extra windows open here, but that will sort itself out. But still, yeah, the message is coming through and it will.
Should I close my windows here?
If you do have any extra windows, yeah, let's just all close our windows here. But let's make sure that we open up the most important window of all, and that's the window to the mind's eye, which is, you know, something psychedelics go hand in hand with. So I mean, yeah, like let's really bring it back. So presuming that somebody might be listening to this conversation who is really not familiar with psychedelics, I mean, in terms of even the word psychedelic, it's really interesting because I always like to think of like the epistemology of language and where it actually roots from. And like the word psychedelic means like psyche, referring to mind. Then the other word, delos, refers to the term visible and clear, so or to shine is another way of sort of rooting that. So I mean, psychedelic, I mean, if you were to break it down, it's like, you know, like making them like the clearing of mind, like you said, it's opening us up to another part of what is equally a valid experience within this reality, yet something that culture obviously doesn't encourage. Yet when we think of altered states of consciousness, there's thousands and thousands of other altered states of consciousness. I mean, even when you just think of like, you know, like a couple shots of espresso, or even if you just think of like sugar and things like that. So I mean, it's really the psychedelic conversation has really been a difficult one to have because of the language that we as a culture have created, and even just the idea that what we often we use the word drugs. Yet at the same time, when we think of drugs, we have this idea that there are good drugs and there are bad drugs. So right away, there's like this schism between like drugs being you think of like the pharmaceutical drugs, and that's what we're told is good. And then we have these other drugs that are bad. So, I mean, it through what we can do here on the radio show is just being able to help create, help refine the language that we're using. So, Oliver, what are psychedelics? I mean, even just sort of like giving us a list of examples, like I said, kind of for someone who might be completely unfamiliar to them, what are psychedelics? Like, what is their role?
Well, as you mentioned, the word itself means the revealing of the soul as well. That's another mm-hmm. kind of interpretation of the Greek in it, so that it uncovers the soul. So what you're or the mind, that's the other, either soul or mind, it could be interpreted either way. So, and when they say that, they're not only saying your mind, but the mind, if you will, the mm-hmm. mind of nature, the mind of the universe. So we're talking about a very, very powerful experience. They are very powerful drugs. You know, LSD was considered, when it was first discovered, as the most powerful psychoactive drug ever, right? In minuscule dosages, it would have mm-hmm. still a very dramatic effect. So we are talking about very powerful substances. We are talking about mind-altering substances. We are talking about things that are non-addictive. All psychedelics are non-addictive drugs. Physiologically, they can be psychologically addictive because people can be addicted to anything, as we all know. So that's some of the definition of it. You know, people are talking about these things in terms of entheogens, which means discovering the divine within, or the divine within. Something like MDMA, which I do consider as a psychedelic, as do some other people, but it's not a classical psychedelic. The classical psychedelics, such as LSD, DMT, PT, mescaline, San Pedro, are serotonergic psychedelics. They're called classical psychedelics. MDMA affects the serotonergic system, but in a different way than the classical psychedelics. MDMA is considered two terms that have been given to it, an entactogen as well as a empathogen. The empathogen means that it creates a sense of with the world and with other people and with the self. I think when we're talking about these substances, we're talking about something that is, you know, very, very different from the opiate, very different from the stimulants like cocaine. So they really should be in a different category. They shouldn't, you know, to lump LSD and heroin together is quite ridiculous.
Right. So what about even just like the obvious question, marijuana perhaps being like one of the most common plants that is used worldwide, where would you classify that?
Well, I do position it within psychedelics simply mm-hmm. because with the use of it, you will have an experience of self. You can experience very much, you know, it can give a direct confrontation with the issues that you need to deal with. And certainly it can be hallucinogenic. With enough of a dosage, it will create that effect. Though it doesn't affect the same kind of systems as the classical psychedelics like LSD or DMT.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I mean, you know, again, like for people who may be new to this stuff, like there's quite a list there, which is a really interesting thing that I'm always fascinated by. Is the you know, even when you think back to sort of like this bigger picture, that everything on this planet is here for some sort of reason, and a lot of those particular reasons in the case of these plants is the integration of it within like our own experience. And one of the things that you know, one of the people who I was personally really fascinated with when I was young and getting into a lot of this information myself, and I'll
still
say it
very young. Sorry.
Oh yeah, I mean, yeah, 25 is still young. Yeah, you're right. I've been around for a while, but yeah. But anyways, you know, Terrence McKenna was a person who I was fascinated with growing up, and just because at that time the internet was still kind of new, but there was a lot of Terrence McKenna videos out there, and I was like, whoa, you know, like first of all, this guy like sounds like hilarious, you know, just like the way his tonation and stuff like that. So that just drew me in. But he brought up a lot of excellent points, and even like the idea of like society trying to control the experiences that we as humans should have our own responsibility towards. You know, like to take responsibility of one's own connection to godness is a very, you know, that's a very important thing. And he even talks about like the idea that like the psychedelic experience is an equally valuable experience within the broader human experience as something such as like having sex, as something such as like giving birth and all these, you know, monumental experiences. Now obviously, you know, like we're not, again, like for Paradigm Shift Radio and for everything here, we're not encouraging people to go out and do psychedelics. That's not what we're saying. What's happening right here is that we are encouraging the conversation about these topics. So just to make sure that that's clear for everyone. But yes, like there's testimony after testimony after testimony of people who have used these medicines, and that's something I'd like to get into within this next question. Is, you know, like how the word medicine sort of helps us sort of think about them a little bit differently. So I mean, you know, like based on what we actually see within, I'm not entirely sure how present it is within the film, but based on, people who you've talked to over the years, what are some of the experiences that people have had through the interaction with these psychedelics and how it has changed their lives in, subtle and radical ways?
Well, I think that you've touched on a pile of different subjects there, so I'll try to arrive at your question, but I do think that some things need to be addressed, and that's that Michael Winkelman, who wrote a book called Psychedelic Medicines, he co-edited that with another researcher, and Michael Winkelman is a University of Arizona professor. It's a two-volume work, and he calls psychedelics rare neurotransmitters. That they are within the environment, that and they allow us a possibility of envisioning the world ingestion of these neurotransmitters that allows us to see the world in a different way. Mm-hmm. So it allows us to again revision the world. When we talk about what kind of experiences people have had under these things, and we bring it to this idea of medicine, in the film, in my film, Nero's Nirvana, a group out of Johns Hopkins has done all of this research with people who are suffering from cancer, who are suffering from anxiety because of their approaching death. So these are people in their 60s, 70s, who are suffering tremendously from the horrors of recognizing their own mortality and pain and suffering. And that has an effect for so many different things, not only yourself, but all of the people that you're surrounded with, your family, your friends, and so on. These are the people that were brought into this trial at Johns Hopkins. And with the use of psilocybin, many of them reported a great relief from their anxiety. So, one session of psilocybin allowed them to refresh their lives. Mm-hmm. There's a very few, in a way that did not, it doesn't dull them like an opiate would. It doesn't put them to sleep. It wakes them up. It wakes them up to the awe of life. So this is a tremendous medicine for that kind of anxiety.
Mm-hmm.
I think a good example of why these things should be used, and certainly in terms of people who are suffering from anxiety issues.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and again, just sort of for clarification, for anybody who may not be familiar, psilocybin is just another way of referring to mushrooms, quote unquote magic mushrooms. That's just more of the scientific term for it. So again, just covering basics there. But yeah, what are some? I mean, even the topic of post-traumatic stress disorder, whether it be relating to something that could have been like a car accident, or there's all sorts of ways that people experience post-traumatic stress disorder, and obviously a lot of people when you think of the term, you think of like soldiers coming home from the military and stuff. What are your thoughts and perspectives on these psychedelics being used to help treat these post-traumatic stress conditions?
Well, certainly something like MDMA is very, very useful for that particular problem. And the reason why is that it's not hallucinogenic. You don't experience any kind of visions or anything of that nature. It's on a particular dosage of it. It will allow you to revision or to go back to the traumatic event to revisit the traumatic event. And when you have that revisiting, but in a way in which you are in a calm state, you're not troubled by it. And MDMA seems to allow people the opportunity to experience again the trauma, but in a safe and calm place. But this is, again, this is with supervision, if you will. This is with the help of a therapist. So it's not, of course, done in a party scene. It's not chaotic. It's not bringing, you know, you're prepared. There's a set and setting balance to the experience so that you can calmly enter into this revisiting of the trauma, and by that you can deal with it in a healthy manner. So you know, a lot of trials are being there's a trial just beginning in Canada right now with Ingrid Pacey, MD, and Andrew Felmar in Vancouver with MDMA for post-traumatic stress disorder, and that's just started. That will just be starting this year. They've just received the MDMA from Switzerland. It's locked up in a safe somewhere in Vancouver. So, you know, this is something that will. So, you know, we know that, you know, street ecstasy is available for anyone can get it. But the problem with it, street ecstasy, as you well know, is that it can be adulterated with stuff that is very, very, very dangerous. So, you know, should be tested out before you ever do any of that.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, that's a big issue in itself. Like the idea that because these substances are illegal, people who are looking to be able to work with them and, you know, literally work with them, oftentimes they do have to go through unconventional methods that, like you said, they you can sort of put them in contact with a bad batch, and then people are being put at unnecessary risk. I heard recently, just a couple weeks ago, maybe I'm sure you heard about this. There was something that came up within Canadian law. They were talking about like sort of changing the law on the restrictions of some of the quote unquote drugs, and just being able to like move forward in this step of being able to have them available for the people who need them in a more like. A controlled way, supervised way. Is that something that you're familiar with? Did you hear about that?
Well, the issue of harm reduction is very important, and this is very much related to prohibition. So because we are living in a state, basically most places in the world that force these substances and drugs underground, we have a very we have an illicit market, and because we have an illicit market, there are people that take advantage of that in so many ways, and so we have adulterated pills and bad shit happening, really bad shit happening, you know, people dying because of it. So, and this is directly related to prohibition. It's not, you know, it's, I don't, in my opinion, it's not a problem of the drugs, it's a problem of the people. Right, the people who are in charge who are not recognizing the potential of these medicines and allowing them for proper use. So, I don't know specifically the details that you're talking about, but I do know that Gabor Mate, who works out of Vancouver, who worked with ayahuasca for many years, and he was using it working with Native people, with First Nations people, for addiction purposes, was sent a letter by the Canadian Medical Association, said, you know, you got to stop doing this.
Yeah, yeah.
Otherwise, we'll take away your license. And he stopped working with it. I mean, he'll still talk about his experiences with it and how valid it was and how useful it is. And there is a recent article or paper put out by the University of Victoria about ayahuasca treatment in Canada with First Nations people, and it's quite quite remarkable. I can send you a copy of it at some point.
Oh, that'd be wonderful. Yeah. So just going back to the word medicine, I think that's something that, I mean, obviously the film of the movie is understanding psychedelic medicines. I mean, you know, you didn't say understanding psychedelic drugs, like you use the word medicine. and for a reason. And to sort of create the sort of bring up the obvious point here, medicine, even going back to indigenous cultures, I mean, there's medicine that treats the physical ailments, and then there's also medicine that treats the mental and the spiritual ailments. Just go a little bit deeper in terms of like what medicine means to you and how this is expressed throughout the film and the project.
Well, that's great. Thank you. I think that if we really understand the term medicine, and I think that we could really discover health, if you will. So medicine really is an attitude. It's the attitude of openness and gratitude to the world and to each other. And these medicines allow you to experience profoundly the beauty of the world. So in that sense, I was talking to a peyote woman, a woman who works with the North American, with the Native American church, and she sings peyote songs during peyote ceremonies, I guess I mentioned her because, you know, the Native people, a lot of Native people have been using these substances like mescaline or peyote or ayahuasca for centuries, right? For a lot longer than we have had medicine. Before the West had medicine, these First Nations people had their medicine as well. And that's a medicine that deals with the soul, one's own soul in relationship to the world. So, you know, for me, medicine means not only myself, but my relationship. All my relationships. So all my relationships to the plants, to the animals, to myself, to my lover, to my country, to you on the radio, to the technology that I live with, all of it.
Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. So one thing that I would really like to be able to do here, since I mean, with the topic understanding psychedelic medicines, I'd actually like to be able to sort of touch upon briefly a handful of at least of the variety of psychedelic medicines that are out there, and just sort of the different ways that they interact with our experience, and just to sort of, you know, give people like not to get caught up on the fascination with the experience, but again, just to give people an idea and to educate on to how these different medicines work differently with us. You know, like, why would someone choose to do ayahuasca opposed to doing MDMA? You know, like, what would they be looking for differently out of one experience that they won't find in another? So I'd really like to get into that. But before we do that, Oliver, I just wanted to really just give you kind of like an open opportunity to bring up anything that you feel is pertinent to mention about this topic and about this film. And then if you're cool with that idea, then we can go into that after we sort of cover anything that we need to cover right here and now.
The only thing I'd like to mention is that the film does not condone, and I do not condone use other than within a traditional or therapeutic experience. These things are too sacred and powerful to be trifled with. And that's my opinion. That's an opinion that's based on like a long time, you know, so long engagement here. And that's my perspective. My perspective is that.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of other topics that I think we'll sort of jump off into from where we need to take this, like even just relating to how these psychedelics can help with creativity and how it can help with meditation as well. And ultimately, you know, the one thing that we here at Paradigm Shift remind people about is how potent of a tool meditation itself is. And you know, people And we'll sort of get into this. People get caught up in the idea of like the brain reaching these altered states of consciousness. Well, we want to remind people and encourage them that through the work with meditation, you can reach these states as well, and even go into states that some of these medicines won't necessarily be able to take you to. So be sure to meditate, boys and girls. That's something we here at Paradigm Shift Radio always encourage people to do. And we will be doing a group meditation later on in the show, perhaps maybe around 12:20. So stick around for that. It's going to be a unique one. And the reason for that is because I have some specific music set aside for it. It's a track by Spongle. Many of you may be familiar with that genre of music. So we're going to kind of do a meditation kind of in theme with the vibe of psychedelics and art inspired by psychedelics. And I mean, that's a topic in itself, you know, going back to how these can inspire creativity. And, you know, you think of artists like Alex Gray and all these, this entire new generation of transformational artists who are coming to the forefront, who have openly, you know, I think where we're coming to right now, and I am comfortable enough to be able to take this step forward, and I hope other people follow me. And you know, big shout out to any NSA agents who might be listening to the show. But I mean, not that that's anything we have to be worried about. But I mean, because this conversation is important. But I mean, yes, I've had my own experience working with these medicines, and for me myself, yes, it has made an impact on my life. And when you really, from my perspective, when you really sort of look at like the role of these medicines, and this is something we've talked about in the past with Paradigm Shift, the perception that we have of this reality right here and now, presuming that you're listening to this show and you're sober, the perception that we have is one that is filtered, meaning it is an illusion, but in the sense that there is actually more to it. There is more energy around us. You know, you can think of like radio waves and gamma waves and like the pulses as being created by our heart, and just like all this energy that is constantly surrounding us, but our perception filters it out. And then you get into the idea of the third eye, and the idea that, like, you know, when you talk about like the pineal gland, that's commonly associated with the third eye, and there's actually a lens to it. And just recently there was an official study that came out talking about how the pineal gland actually does produce DMT. Prior to just recently, it was a theory related to Strassman's work, Rick Strassman. And again, you know, we'll talk about DMT in a minute just to bring some clarity to all this. But for me, like, these psychedelics, they do that. They open us up to more perception of the reality around us. When people think of psychedelics and they think of hallucinations, I think a lot of people think that hallucination means it's not real, or, you know, you're just making it up in your head. Whereas in some cases, and Oliver, I'd like to hear your response to this, I think that what we see through these psychedelic experiences, and in particular, I think of things like the psilocybin mushrooms and DMT and ayahuasca, in some cases, what we're seeing is actually more real. It's actually like more of what reality is. And that's what brings it back to this expansion of it dissolves the boundaries. It opens you up into this idea of oneness. It brings us back to the root of what psychedelic means and connecting to that divinity, that godness. And there's a reason why people do psychedelics, do mushrooms, and are drawn outside into nature. You know, they just want to be outside with nature and just like, oh my God, like, this was right here in front of me, and for some reason I couldn't see it, but now it's like so incredibly obvious. And again, it just sort of takes that squeegee to their third eye and helps see the world around them. So, I mean, I'm not really sure if I have an immediate question, but Oliver, like, yeah, like, do you have a response based on just sort of what I said there? Just the idea
yeah,
that
sure,
these
sure.
open up our perception.
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure, absolutely, but you know, I'm gonna bring in a little bit of a downer with it, because why I'm going to do that is that if one is not properly prepared, right? If one is not solid enough in one's own relationship, okay? First Nations people say all my relations, right? That term and it means that, you know, if you don't have your shit together, right, or if or if you go there, and I've had friends do this. I've had, you know, when I was quite young, you know, early teens, late teens, I should say, you know, go off on very heavy acid trips, and you know, it was very difficult for them to come back.
Yeah,
you know, because they had nowhere to nobody to talk to about it, or it was very difficult for them to come back to a world in which, you know, they had a lot of responsibilities, or you know, their parents couldn't talk to them, or they couldn't talk to anybody else, and you know, really, really, really tough. So it's important to have the preparation and the when you come back, to have enough of a space, enough slack in your life that you can process it, right? It's not only the experience, it's got to, you got to process all this information. And you know, that's where meditation helps. And you know, ultimately you know, I'll tell you a story about one ayahuasca experience I had, where you know, the group of us were out in, it was in Peru, so it was all legal and you know, acceptable and all the rest, because it's legal there. Anyways, one fellow wanted to go out to, wanted an experience of space travel, right? That's what he wanted, and that was his desire. The day that the ceremony was taking place, I was swimming in a pond right beside the ceremony area, and this
Sorry, just repeat the last 5 seconds. We just cut out for a second.
Sure. So I was swimming in this pond by this ayahuasca ceremony area, and I was in this pond, and very bizarre creatures. And this world is full of wonder. You don't need to go anywhere. You know, if you're high enough, you can find this.
We're just getting a little extra choppiness, I think, and I think people live chat will confirm it. Block Talk does this, it'll fix itself out. Try again. Just talk back to me for a second.
Can you hear me now? How's that? Is that better?
Yeah. It seems okay now. So yeah, go ahead. So you were saying, just introduce the story.
So go ahead. Tell me where I was.
Someone wanted to go to space.
Oh yeah. Okay, so you know, it's sort of like this great desire to have the wild experience. And really, if you look around you, if you really take a look at your world right now, you'll see that it's quite amazing. And you know, that the fullness of this world is stupendous. I just, you know, when you do psychedelic, think that this space you should kind of in a way.
Hold on, it's chopping up again. People in the live chat, just confirm for me that it is chopping up for you, and it's not just something I'm hearing on my end. Yeah, it's weird. Like it's a technical thing. I don't know. The Block Talk is trying to censor us. What's going on here? The Illuminati. Okay. try again though. I mean, it was fine before, so I think it just needs to go through a couple hiccups here. So try again.
Okay. Let's try. I'm just suggesting that people really need to enter into it with a position of gratitude. The more that you enter into it with real appreciation of what the world really is, what the world is, then your journey will be much more beneficial for yourself and for everybody else that will, you know, that you'll run into. And I'm also suggesting that, you know, when you do it, when it's a very heavy trip, very heavy age with you, this thing of self, if you haven't built up a self, if you haven't created an identity, you're really quite young.
Okay, it's doing its thing. Sorry, I hate to cut you off. It seems to.
Sure, no worries.
I mean, I'm just sort of picking up a pattern here. It seems to be fine, and then about 20 seconds in of you talking, it seems to get choppy. So, but yeah, it's like just a, I mean, I'm just going to talk for a second, and maybe it'll fix itself. But I totally agree with you that people, in order to get the best experience out of these psychedelics, it involves a certain level of maturity going into it. You're right. Like someone can be very put off by a psychedelic experience if they are just handed something like mushrooms or LSD at a party with no proper context, with no ceremony, no literal ceremony, and they're sort of thrown into this other state of reality, and they're there for quite a while. You know, it's quite a commitment when you're working with something like mushrooms and LSD and acid or and ayahuasca. You know, that's something that's going to last like 5, 6, 7 hours. And it's not something that you just say like, okay, I'm done with this. Like, it's something that, you know, you're put through. And one thing, you know, I just sort of want to bring it back to one simple idea that I think all of these psychedelics are helping us understand, and that's the spiritual aspect of this reality, just to sort of state the obvious. A lot of people who are listening to this show are opening up to the idea that, like, we are spiritual beings, we are more than our physical body, there is more to this reality, it's not as cut and dry as it appears to be. And these psychedelics, while we're in this state, while we're working with them, our thoughts create so much. So the intention that we bring into the practice, into the ceremony, is mm-hmm. incredibly, incredibly mm-hmm. reflected by what we experience. So try talking again. I'll let you know if it gets choppy.
Yeah, that's clearly it. You know, talking about intent. So the intent of that engagement when you first accept the premise of journeying, then mm-hmm. Figure out where you want to go in some ways. I also want to let you know that that, you know, you can get into spaces that humans are not basically meant to be in. I mean, it's not like, you know, it's not, you know, we're time based creatures, and you can go into in spaces that are, you know, not time based at all. And it can be very discombobulating, even for the journeyer to be in spaces that time-based thing doesn't exist. We're not talking about a colorful experience. We're talking about a philosophical engagement here that's unordinary. And, you know, the more preparation, the more understanding, the more engagement that you can have mm-hmm. with the complexities of mind, then the better off you'll be. So that's why, you know, meditation, yoga, highly recommended, because these guys have been practicing mind-altering exercises for centuries as well. You know, it's the same thing, you know.
Yeah. We did. It was a little choppy there, but I think we were using our psychic abilities, and we got part of what you were talking about. But yeah, as I totally just reiterating. I mean, yeah, like it would be, or sorry, not necessarily to reiterate, but just to expand upon one dream, literally like a dream that I would love to see, and it's something that. I mean, it would be new to our culture, but it's actually reminiscent of ancient cultures and perhaps future cultures as well. But a culture that actually encourages the education of working with these medicines. And I would love to, you know, see them encouraged in a way that, say, like when a young man or woman turns the age of like 17 or 18, that they embark on their first exploration into these other states of consciousness with something like psychedelics, or in particular like mushrooms would be something in particular to start off with. And just really the idea, and this is something, you know, going back to like Terrence McKenna, like the idea of thinking of yourself as an explorer, like you literally are an explorer of consciousness, and you're venturing into what you're talking about, going into You can even think of them, depending on the substance that you're using, you can literally think of them as like other dimensions. And like you said, other places where we as humans do not normally reside, but we can exist within, even just like temporarily. And the amazing thing is that within these other spaces, you get reports of people interacting with intelligences that seem to reside within these other dimensions. And this is something that people consistently talk about through DMT experiences and even ayahuasca, and not necessarily so much on mushrooms. I mean, depending on the dosage, I guess. But that's something that I'm just personally very fascinated with, is the idea that through psychedelics, and I'm not totally sure if this is, you know, like within the film that you make. I mean, obviously you have to be conscious as to like how much you're really putting out to the audience, because you don't want, if you're trying to get this out to a mainstream, I can't imagine that you'd really get too deep into the idea of like, you know, oh, we want to encourage the education about psychedelics because it's going to help us talk to little green men in other dimensions. You know, like that's probably going to scare away a couple politicians. So, I mean, I'd be curious to sort of hear like where you sort of draw the line in terms of like telling them so much about the information. But yeah, like it's just fascinating to think that these other realms, these other dimensions, are accessible from the driver's seat of the human body, and it's an amazing thing to sort of be able to explore these states, and then to most importantly, to be able to bring something back, to be that psychonaut that brings something back with us. So, sorry, Oliver, go ahead. I felt like I spoke for too long there. So
no worries. I'm happy to hear your comments and your perspective. For myself, I'm more inclined to Alan Watts and Aldous Huxley. Mm-hmm. And that is that you know, you can experience all sorts of things, but you know, reality is what it's about. You know, for me, it's like ultimate reality, and that ultimate reality is my relationships and responsibilities. And you know, it sounds like a bummer, but it's not really, or a down, or whatever you want, whatever it's called today. But what it's about is being a vibrant to reality. It's like tuning into the tuning of the world, the music of the world, the synchronicity of the world. You know, and so for me, it's not so much journeying as much as finding, as being, and ultimately being, you know, appreciating, all right? Because you will appreciate all these other beings. It's not that I'm, you know, dismissive or blind to all of this different energies, but I guess, you know, you become the stream itself rather than particles of the stream. So that for me is the interesting aspect of psychedelics, is that you can you know, feel the waves of feel the river flow, you know, and that will allow you to move as you should, you know. So it's always an engagement with others in that movement, and that's why I really liked actually your introduction to Paradigm Shift Radio, because, or the Paradigm Shift Movement, because that is really what it's about. It is a shift towards that kind of a community that that is you know, respectful and in gratitude, I think, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So one thing that we sort of touched upon it earlier, and kind of going back to my original idea, I would sort of like to almost take a little bit of time to sort of individually talk about some of the psychedelic medicines and just give each one a little bit of time on its own and give it that space. But one thing I just want to bring up first is the importance of ceremony and how much that can play a role. And this, you know, kind of tying in with what we were talking about, just like the responsibility in the preparation of going into it. I do also have another question that's come in off the side, and actually this one I feel is actually a little bit more pertinent. So let's address this one first, because it's something that a lot of people can relate to. What based on your experience and in your opinion, what suggestions would you have for someone who perhaps is having a quote unquote a bad trip? And you know, even if it's something like with marijuana, you know, some people with using cannabis, it can be a very psychological thing too. You know, in those states, you'd be like, oh, you know, like, am I tripping out? I think I'm tripping out. Oh no, I'm tripping out. And then, you know, you totally put yourself there, right? Like, and again, going back to like the thoughts create, what suggestions would you have for people who sort of find themselves in that place or something to prevent themselves from finding themselves in that place again in the future?
Well, sometimes it may not be your medicine, right? So you know, for future reference, right? So if you experience something that is very negative, or you know, you might want to say, well, okay, I'll step away from that for a while until I feel ready to go through it. When you're in it, though, because it, as you mentioned so clearly, there's a kind of refraction, there's a kind of mirroring that goes on, and the more that you resist, the more that you will suffer the consequences of your resistance. Mm-hmm. So it's really important to really let go. Actually, in with any drug, you can learn something from the drug, and the drug will, but only if you can appreciate what it's telling you. So, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. learn from it and don't resist. And that's pretty well the most important thing. And also breathing, you know, it's to return breathing. to the breath, to really notice your breath, and that will usually bring you home. You know, that will usually bring you to the body. They'll bring you to your connection with other people and to the world. So by focusing very, and you can usually actually just concentrate just below the nose. Just the sense of the skin and feeling the air moving around your nose, that will probably usually bring you back to just to that. So but you have to concentrate. There has to be a willful engagement with it, so that you can calm yourself. Because these things are a mirroring. So if you feel uncomfortable, that's because you're feeling uncomfortable with something that is being presented to you, and you know, it's usually we have to deal with that. Right? Yeah. It's something that we have to deal with. I mean,
Absolutely. Bringing it back to the breath is an obvious yet excellent suggestion, and one that's perhaps so obvious that in the moment we kind of forget that how powerful of a tool the breath actually is. And yeah, just kind of taking that moment and again, like you said, just being able to embrace and let it flow, whatever experience is kind of coming your way. And setting an intention is such a key part of it. I mean, for me personally, with my through the evolution of my own maturity, I've really sort of changed my perspective on how I work with these medicines, with these teachers. You know, my buddy, he was kind of, when he said that, he's like, you know, like these plants, like they're teachers, like they actually are teachers. Like there's like an intelligence behind them. There's an intelligence to the mushroom. There's an intelligence to the cannabis. There's an intelligence to the ayahuasca. And that's something that I'm incredibly fascinated with, the idea that there's a consistent telling of people who work with ayahuasca, and they talk about like the mother ayahuasca, like this spirit of the ayahuasca who connects with them through the experience. And Go ahead. Yeah, I'm sure you have.
Have you read Jeremy Narby's books? Do you know Jeremy Narby?
No.
Oh,
no.
You really got to get a hold of Narby's material, because his Cosmic Serpents is really fantastic. And he's written also a book about the intelligence of plants as well. It's really wonderful because and he's in the film as well. He's quite focused or quite prominent in both versions of the film. He talks about plants as being intelligent and informative, as well as Dennis McKenna. Of course, Dennis talks about that. Yeah. And, you know, we are closely connected to these things. They are our cousins, if you will, And you know, I really appreciate what you're saying, and I think that if we again be patient enough with ourselves to learn the patience that the plants have, right? These things are very patient. These things grow very slowly, usually, you know, comparatively. And and what they're doing is they're absorbing sunlight, you know, most of the time.
Yeah,
They are these vehicles of transformation. They're chemical messengers, if you will. That's one of the terms that Dennis uses.
Yeah.
And, you know, so.
Absolutely, yeah. Like I like what you said. I mean, evidently it is. It's like the transmutation of sunlight energy, which is, you know, we are infinite light unfolding infinitely upon itself through the beautiful spectrum of fractals and infinity and colors that we have yet to even imagine, but are there. They are there.
Did you just come up with that?
Oh, well, I mean, you know what, through my own experience, and this is something that, you know, I brought it up on a past episode, and again, not to get like caught up in the fascination with the individual experiences, but I have had my own experience with DMT, and DMT, for those people who may not be familiar, DMT, in one way, it can be referred to as like the most potent psychedelic. If you're it as a substance itself, it can be extracted from common grass. There are particular trees, and it's also found within one of the vines, which is made into the ayahuasca brew. And that brew, when ingested, lasts for several hours within the ceremony. But when extracted and turned into a crystallized form, it can be smoked out of a regular glass pipe. And when that's the case, it can be a short duration unless there's an inhibitor involved, such as Syrian rue. And for myself, when I had this experience smoking DMT, it was a huge, huge, huge affirmation for me, because at that point I was looking at nature around me. I was starting to see the sacred geometry. I was starting to see the fractals. I was looking at a tree and I was like, wow, this tree is teaching me something about myself, about reality, about the perception of time. Like, as is above, so is below. Like, the roots below the tree are equally as important as the roots above the tree. And that's like the symbolism of the human soul evolving. Evolving both like in and out of itself. And when I had my own DMT experience, what literally happened, there's this process where it opens up the third eye, the filters just come completely off, and you see the world around you in a way that is much more real than what it is when we have our filters on. I mean, everything is equally unreal is kind of a quote that I pull from the Carlos Castaneda books about Don Juan. Many people, I'm sure, are familiar with that. But when I, going back to what I said, you know, when I had this experience, it was a huge affirmation for me, because I literally saw what I can best refer to as the code of the matrix. And it literally was infinite light unfolding infinitely upon itself through like sacred geometry and fractals. And I was seeing it firsthand. And, you know, I was just like, it was like, oh my God, like this is, you know, this is like, looks like Alex Gray art. And there's a reason for that, because Alex Gray has had his own experiences with that. And then as an artist, he tries to bring that into a form to share and inspire people. But the one thing that I really got from that experience is that for me, there's a huge sense of familiarity with that experience. I was like, wow, I have been here before. It is something that I have been to kind of like between lives. And That is a topic which I'm really interested in as well, and I would love to hear your thoughts on that, Oliver. Just the relationship between some psychedelic experiences and near-death experiences, and how both of those can be catalysts for change and opening up our perception as well. But yeah, I mean, just going back to my own personal experience and not advocating anything here, because DMT is you know, it's an illegal substance in itself, but the discussion about it is something that I just feel is valuable. It's valuable to know that these experiences are real, that they exist, that they are out there, and it's a part of the human experiences for those who choose to go down that road. So, Oliver, do you have anything you just want to add? Or
yeah, yeah, I just wanted to clarify a few things. It's the shikuna leaves that have the DMT in it, in the mixture, and it's the MAO inhibitor is in the ayahuasca, and that inhibitor is a harmaline. So in the ayahuasca brew, you're also getting harmaline, which originally was called telepathine. That was the original language for it. The original signature of that molecule was telepathine, which is a great ID. And when you talk about these experiences, I really appreciate what you're saying, and I respect where you go, and I really understand it. I just want to let people know that some of these, sometimes this is another, if you will, lessons that can be had from the experiences, that you have to not be too attached to that vision, because it's very hard to come back and go, my God, my bedroom is not very neat today, you know? So there's this kind of, you know, you've just entered into the sacred geometry of reality, if you will, and the light of God, or however you want to term this transient and transcendent experience. So, you know, it's something that you really can't be, it has to be the same as, if you will, it has to be the same as doing the dishes. They're really, I know that that's hard to believe, but that's really where it's got to be, so that you can not be too attracted to it, simply because that's not where we all always are. I mean, you can bring it back through meditation, if you will, and you can have it kind of like a like an onion skin, so it can be an onion skin experience, right? So that it's there, but you're still seeing the dishes quite properly, you know. And it's bodily, so you bring it into your body. That's very important as well, of course.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Very cool. Go ahead.
I'm also trying to think about, yes, absolutely. For visionary artists, it's really important. And I think that you know, in terms of creativity, that then you can see the connections, you can see the relationships. And that can inspire other people, but you know, we don't want to be caught. I don't think it's. I'm an artist myself, and I work with digital. I do some stuff with fairly highly complicated mathematical structures to refigure imagery. As an example, I use the last piece I used. What's the guy's name now? I can't remember. But it basically uses a torus, and you stretch the image through a torus a certain kind of way, and you keep on stretching it. And as you, with the image on the torus, stretching it, it eventually turns into noise. But you can also start seeing pattern recognitions through the noise of the original image, and so I used that as a base for a video that I did. And what I'm trying to suggest here is that there are many ways of interpreting these visions, so that we don't become cliche with it. And I think that that's the danger of some visual artists. And I'm not. You know, I love Alex Gray's work, and there's many that are great. But I just, you know, there are many visions. We, you know, and it should be used that way. You know, we shouldn't become cliche. That's all.
Yeah.
You know.
Very, yeah. Good point. Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. It's amazing to see a lot of the art, as I mentioned, that is emerging through culture, and there's so much of it out there.
Well, it's now, sort of like, I just want you to mention Steve Jobs did acid, and he said it was the most important experience of his life. But he was really into fonts. You know, he's really into scene design. So, you know, he was not into, you know, swirling or, you're right? So, you know, you can go, there's many, many worlds to visit.
Yeah. That's a topic in itself. Just the idea of how many people there are within mainstream culture, so to speak, who have had their own experiences with psychedelics, yet have very few of them have been able to openly talk about it. And but it's definitely had an impact on their lives. I mean, Steve Jobs is an example. I mean, obviously he's mentioned it. One person in particular that I think of here, not to spend too much time on this, but Jim Carrey. There's a video of him up on the internet, and it just talks about like this revelation that he went through, and you know that it was just, you know, one of those very deep states of meditation, but just the way, the look in his eyes, like he saw something. He saw something like beyond the veil of illusion, and but he didn't, you know, he wasn't able to like say it, but it would be amazing if we can, as a culture, get to the point where people who are in these role model positions are talking about these very real experiences, but again, being able to talk about it with a level of maturity where they're not advocating it, and they're not keeping in mind that, you know, like there's so many young influential children, like younger teens who are out there, and that would be something that would obviously just have to be taken into mind, is like, as this conversation gets more into culture, how do we really just be able to bring it to a level where they can understand it, and they can be able to respect it appropriately. And I'd love to just sort of you know, because just really, really focusing on this film here and this project and more about like what you would like to see it accomplish. Like, how do you feel that this film, Neurons to Nirvana, and again, for everybody, please contribute and share the Kickstarter page, and again, facebook.com/neuronstonirvana, and support this very important project. How do you feel that once we successfully contribute and raise the funds needed for getting this film out there, how would you envision it being able to influence culture?
Well, currently they are Schedule 1, so that means that they're considered a Schedule 1 in the U.S. So, and Schedule 1 in Canada, so that means they are considered completely taboo, completely without use for any medical condition. And what MAPS is doing, the Multidisciplinary Association for Psychedelic Studies, is trying to do, and what we're in cooperation and in alliance with them are trying to do, is to get these things off of Schedule 1, so that at least there can be proper research with them, and also that they can be used as medicines. And I think that you know, things are moving quite quickly. We are going through a paradigm shift. We are moving quickly. So, you know, cannabis will probably be legal in another 5 years in Canada. You know, we're going to get there. We're definitely going to get there. And as our culture becomes more mature in terms of meditation, yoga, spiritual practices, but you know, without the God, without the hierarchy, and without the system of repression that is currently associated with religion, you know, free inquiry, and you know, so it doesn't become some sort of, you know, problem. The more that we go in that direction, we will have centers, we will have psychedelic centers, we will have initiation rites, and these things will happen. They'll definitely happen in your lifetime. They may even happen in my lifetime. You know, if you have a chance, read Island by Aldous Huxley. Do you know that book?
I mean, I'm familiar with Huxley, but not that particular book.
Okay, sure. You know, highly recommended for everyone, because it's really, you know, it's not such a great read, but it's a great manifesto. It's a manifesto about a psychedelic culture, and it's really about how to use these things within a way of changing culture, changing society, so society becomes aware of itself via these tools.
So
in many ways, this film is a foray and into a discussion that, you know, your grandmother and your mother and other people who, or people who are not very familiar with this, your grandfather or grandfather, whatever it may be, will understand the potential of these things, and they won't be frightened by it, right? Because people have a lot of fear of these things because they've been fed a lot of fear.
Absolutely. Yeah, totally. It's like when I think about this, I mean, not to sort of put like a label on it. I mean, you know, if you were to think of this like the psychedelic revolution or something like that, but I see a lot of parallels between what's happening here and what has happened historically in the past with things that, you know, when we think of like the women's rights movements and even, you know, like gay rights and just what those were and how, you know, it was a process. It was something that took time, but by the end of it, it was almost inevitable, and I think that this film is a huge part of something that can definitely assist in what will evidently be a very important thing within the future of culture. I mean, I agree. Like, if we can get some of these psychedelics more like, you know, like you said, like have them in like a class one, then we can begin doing quote unquote scientific research with them, because there hasn't been enough scientific research, and I'm sure that's something that comes up in your film. You know, like when I think about, in particular, you think about Rick Strassman, who was working with DMT, and he was, you know, doing a study, and he was doing it under sort of like underneath like the guide that it wasn't really supposed to be something super duper spiritual. It was really just about monitoring the effects. But as it became like, you know, as it started unraveling itself and unfolding, and people were just like, whoa, you know, like this is like really sort of like opening up that window a little too wide, they began to like shut them down, kind of thing. But I mean, I think we need to go those places. We need to be able to find out just what the benefits really are of things like, you know, like psilocybin and MDMA, and how those can be greatly influential to the lives of those people who you said maybe who can benefit from them quite widely. So,
well, I you know, of course I agree with you. The importance of the film is not only in the direction of the liberation of these things, so that more scientists can conduct more trials. I mean, there was a tremendous amount of research done in the 60s and 70s, in the mid 60s and late 70s, I mean, and mid 70s to LSD and LSD's use in alcoholism, very, very successful recovery rates with that. But a lot of this was shut down. It was shut down for particular reasons, particular political reasons. It had very little to do with the drugs themselves, the dangers of the drugs, if you will. You know, that's not to smooth over the fact that they can be dangerous. They can be dangerous if they're badly used. But that, you know, so can cars. You know, everything can be badly used. What we're talking about here is the possibility of recognizing the potentials of these things in terms of understanding our own minds, what we ourselves are, and who we are, and what we can manifest as. And so ultimately the film is about, you know, the liberation of the mind. It's really about appreciating the potentials of substances, natural and some that are really quite unique molecules, to the potentials of ourselves. You know, this, it's cognitive liberty. It's, we're talking about the freedom of our associations and our own brains, right? I mean, you know, no one should tell me what I can and cannot think. That's just, you know, that's first human right.
And
it's a film about the fighting for human rights, if you will, in that level.
Yeah.
You know?
Very much so, yeah. Like, I think you use the word liberation there. Like, I think, yeah, like, again, like, I don't want to try and put a title on this, but, like, yeah, psychedelic liberation or something. But, yeah, just, I mean, these plants, like, they're people too, so to speak. I mean, if you want, not to, like, really say it that way, but, I mean, there's
That's very close. That's what the Peruvian shamans consider,
well,
you know.
That's where I'm kind of coming at it from, yeah.
Yeah.
The allies, like, I think ally is a term that has been brought into my repertoire. Like, that's what these are. And when you think about these plant teachers as being allies, they are allies in the same way that our fruits and our vegetables are allies as well.
Great.
Too. I mean,
absolutely.
Each
Great.
they all provide us with nutrients. I mean, in the same way that, like, an orange or an apple provides you with a certain type of nutrient, working with these medicines will provide you with a certain type of psychological nutrient that you won't necessarily get from something else. So yeah, each one is there for a very, very interesting and incredibly amazing reason. So, and that's something that we're definitely still learning about, and there's still so much to explore. So,
well, when you say that, you know, I think that what you're saying is really actually exceedingly important, because it's really a matter of, again, this kind of gratitude of the world. So
yeah.
The more that we can
yeah.
Appreciate this is really the paradigm shift. The paradigm shift has to do with appreciating everything in your environment,
mm-hmm.
so that you can actually really understand it. And that understanding, you know, that the appreciation will actually encourage the thing to speak to you. You know, it will go, oh, well, that person or that entity is not so arrogant that it doesn't want to, you know, that thinks it's the only thing in the world,
mm-hmm.
right? These, you know, I just read recently in a scientific journal that certain plants will communicate through sound. Right, some sort of sound
yes,
mechanism
yeah.
to another plant to encourage it to grow. Right, there are certain plants that will, you know, speak to another plant to get it to grow. I mean, that's mind-boggling.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
And that was, and I'm not talking New Age. I'm talking about this was a scientific paper.
Yeah.
You know, done in a like in Nature journal, right? A serious journal. So you know, these things are. The world is much more complicated than we've been led on to believe it is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Well, Oliver, it's been an amazing conversation that we've been having up until this point. Now, I'd just like to be able to ask you, is there a way that people can contact you personally? Are you open to that?
Sure. No worries. I mean,
how would they do that?
Yeah. Oliver dot. Just you know, I easily found via Google, you know, pretty easily found via Google, but it's just OliverHockenhall@gmail.com.
Okay. All right. So yeah, so it, maybe if somebody like has a question, is that okay?
Sure,
'cause I mean,
sure.
Yeah, feel
sure.
free to,
appreciate
all right, well, yeah, well, there you go, folks. If you would perhaps have another question for Oliver, because I mean, I think what kind of going back to what I was saying, like, you know, like there are a lot of people who simply haven't been educated about these topics, and they do have a lot of questions. So it's important for people such as yourself, such as me, to be able to openly have these conversations with them, and to not try and like preach, to not try and do any of you know, but to really just listen and to collectively share with the intent to understand rather than the intent to reply. And that's something that Paradigm Shift Radio is and has always and will continue to be about, because that's you know, we really need to be able to paradigm shift the way that we listen in the first place, so that we can have those conversations properly. Now, I would like to be able to get into the meditation, because what I'd actually be able to like to do with this meditation is to be able to collectively work together with the people who are listening to the show, to be able to use our thoughts, to be able to use our mind, to put forth the intention to help move this this movement forward, to help bring this into our reality. If this is something that we agree that we collectively want to see, we want to see more respect for our plant allies, then let's do this. Let's bring it into our meditation, understanding that our thoughts create this reality, and let's project that out there into this this holographic matrix that we are all a part of. And I'm sure the plant allies will appreciate us doing so, and I'm sure they'll be right there with us as we do it. So, Oliver, I would love to keep you on the air after we do our meditation, and perhaps we can bring a couple people on who might have some questions that they want to ask. Is that something you're okay with? Can we do that?
Sure. Sounds okay. Great.
Okay, cool. So if anybody has any sort of question that they might have, or even just a little bit of insight into this conversation about understanding psychedelics, we'll try to keep it short. So think about what you're going to share and see if you can share it within like 5 minutes. That way, so we can bring on a couple people. So just less words, more meaning is kind of the simple way to put it. And we'll do that after the meditation, and that will be within the last 20 minutes of the show as we wrap things up here. Now, again, reminding people, please go to the Facebook page and the Kickstarter page for this project, and let's make sure that this project happens. So, I mean, it's fun to talk about it, but we actually do have to put that step forward. And one of the best ways to support this project is to like it on the Facebook page at facebook.com/neurons2nirvana, and then share it with your friends and share the Kickstarter page, donate whatever you can. And another thing that's very successful is to send individual messages to people who you know. So you can perhaps send them a link for this Paradigm Shift Radio episode through this Blog Talk link or the YouTube link that will be put up tomorrow morning, and tell them, hey, you know, listen to this conversation, and I think it's something you'll be interested in. Here's the link for the Kickstarter page. Please contribute to this project. It's something that I'm very passionate about. And those personal messages do make, I feel, they're very more influential. So please do that, guys, and let's do this. Let's show that as a community we can accomplish some magical things, and we'll continue to do that as we move forward into the future. Now, Oliver, I'm comfortable sort of walking us into this meditation. Are there any sort of particular intents that you would like to place into this meditation before we go into it?
Cross-generational, you know, aspect of that. I think that that's one of the hopes of this piece, as well as to enlighten all ages mm-hmm. to the potentials. And mm-hmm. you know, it's that would be it.
Okay. Perfect. Yeah, cross-generational, absolutely. So now, guys, you do remember that I mentioned the idea of sort of like getting into individual details about these different psychedelics. That may or may not happen within this show, but we do have the Google After Party Hangout that happens in every episode. So some of that may come up within that conversation. So keep an eye open for that on facebook.com/paradigmshiftradio. After the show ends, you'll see the Google Hangout, and you can join it yourself, join in on the conversation, or watch it on YouTube once it's live. So feel free to get involved with that conversation. So with that said, let's get ready to do this. Let's get ready to collectively put our intention out there into the grid and take part in this meditation, and also a celebration of our alliance with these allies, these teachers who are here with us on this journey. You know, we are equally here as much as they are equally here, and this is definitely a shared experience that we're going through together. So, Oliver, if you're okay with that, I'm gonna mute you, and then I'll bring you back on after the meditation. So,
sure. How long is the meditation?
The track that we have is just 6 minutes. So
cool.
I'm just gonna
cool.
do a brief introduction. Excellent. So perfect. All right. Okay. Thank you so much, Oliver. It's been an absolute pleasure so far. So I'll bring you back on after we're done with that. So perfect. All right. So let's get comfortable, everybody. And again, the track that we're going to play with this one, normally we do like a Singing Bowl audio track. With this one, we're going to play some Spongle. And Spongle is an artist, and he himself has been inspired through the use of psychedelics, and that very much comes through his music. So the song in particular is the song Closed Eyelids, and it's not the full track, but you can find it on YouTube. Look up Spongle, Spongle. And he's got a new album coming out soon, so plug your work and check that out. It's a museum of consciousness. I'm looking forward to it, and so should you. So, guys, let's just get comfortable. We're going to move ourselves into this bit of a unique meditation in terms terms of what you want to do actually for it. So just be sitting down on your chair, or maybe you're on bed, or either on a fancy, just to be something that is comfortable. Sorry, guys, can you get me in the chat? Someone's saying that they can't hear me. I want to make sure that you can hear me. Move forward with this meditation. And there's a bit of a delay, so I'm just kind of waiting for that to show up in the chat. So, can't hear you. People are saying they can't hear me. Hold on one second. Hold on, guys. Can you hear me now? And again, I'm just sort of waiting for the delay to catch up. Now I'm better. Okay. Yeah, I just muted, unmuted myself. So, okay. All right. So everything's okay? We're all good. All right, perfect. So again, guys, Spongo track coming up. Check out Spongo's new album. Check out Nerds to Nirvana, facebook.com/Nerds to Nirvana. Support this project. Let's make it happen. Setting the intention of collectively moving forward as a culture, as a society, to be able to open up to the understanding of the alliance that we have with these medicines here on this planet, with the shared consciousness that they can bring our experience into. So getting in that comfortable position for you, let's just relax the shoulders a bit and just take that first breath. So gentle inhale through the nose. Gentle exhale through the nose. And again, just gentle inhale through the nose. Gentle exhale through the nose. Just allowing, as a community, for those here in the now and those in the future now listening to this, synchronizing ourselves through that single breath, through that single heartbeat. Just taking a moment now with that next breath to bring in gratitude, respect, and humility for our plant allies, for our teachers. So again, just gentle inhale, just gratitude to know that they are here with us. Gentle exhale, walking this journey with us. Gentle inhale, they are here to show us more of who we are. Gentle exhale. Gentle inhale, they're here to remind us of our interconnectedness with our surroundings. Gentle exhale. Gentle inhale, they're here to be a mirror, a reflective lens, for us to learn more about ourselves. Gentle exhale. So just set forth that intent right now, through your heart chakra, to be able to emanate and put into the world around you the intention that you hope that more people will be able to see, appreciate, and understand the unity, the communion that we have with these allies here in this reality, and see that reality ahead of us, to vision, to be a visionary of that future, where more people can work alongside and benefit from the experiences and the teachings that these allies are here to share with us. So continue to breathe. Continue to put forth that intention collectively all across the world as a community, as a unity, putting forth the intention of being the change that we wish to see in the world. So continue to follow this rhythm. I'm just going to play the track and let your mind go where it needs to and feel the synthesis between yourself and the spirits of the plants who are here with us on this journey.
In very many cases, the visionary quality of the vision, so to say, spills over into the external world, so that the experiencer, when he opens his eyes, sees the outer world transfigured, sees it as
Just take another gentle breath in through the nose and exhale through the nose. Allow yourself to bring that gratitude into your heart, the fact that we share this reality with our plant allies. So take another simple breath, and as you bring yourself back to your awareness of the room around you, stick around and enjoy the original last few minutes of the show, and feel free to sing along.
Scenario. Up until this point, I mean, I think we had a full show in itself. I think we did accomplish what we set out to do, no doubt. Dun, dun, dun. I'm talking to Oliver at the same time. Okay, Marley, I'm just seeing you type in the chat. Can you hear me, Marley? And I'm talking to Oliver on Skype chat, so. See, I'm not,
I'm in and out, yeah. Like, it's not totally coming through. So, like, I don't think there's, if it's not perfectly clear, like, there's not, I don't really want to just, like, get, like, too far into this. We'll edit the episode and we'll just say that Blog Talk glitched out and we'll end it with the meditation, and I'll include the actual Spongle track into the version that we put online on some sort of tidbit. But just to unofficially kind of wrap up the show here. Yeah, Oliver says love. So for those of you who are still with us, much love from Oliver, who is the director for Neurons to Nirvana, the wonderful guest who we had on tonight. So this is just like a little like casual glitchy time with Brendan here, very laid back and personal. Who wants to hear my singing bowl? Or who wants to hear me just sing in general? What song should I sing, guys? A whole new world, fantastic place and point of view. Something, something, shooting star, no matter where you are. Somebody copy paste me the lyrics for A Whole New World, please. I'll sing it for you. Come on, guys, we got like 5 minutes. Work with me here. You guys should pull it up on YouTube too, so you can sing along. We'll just do like a whole separate paradigm shift episode where it's just like a sing along or something. Okay, hold on. I'm just like doing Google Hangouts, so I have to enter in a verification code. Hello. Hold on. Bloop. 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 One sec. It's gonna work. I think it might. Whoa, glitchy. You don't want to go for a ride, do you? We can get out of the palace, see the world.
Is it safe?
Sure. Do you trust me? What? Do you trust me? Feel free to sing along, guys. We're just gonna have some fun here, and then hang out. Give me a second. I'm still figuring out the hangout. We gotta sing this song first. So for everybody, this is like once in a lifetime opportunity.
I can show you the world, shining, shimmering, splendid. Tell me, princess, now when did you last let your heart decide? I can open your eyes, take you wonder by wonder, over sideways and under on a magic carpet ride, a whole new world.
Oh, I gotta practice more.
A fantastic point of view. No one to tell us no, or where to go.
I'm not trying enough. But I'm not trying to impress you either, so. No, and then there's Jasmine's part.
A dazzling place I never knew. But when I'm way up here, it's crystal clear.
Crystal clear. But now it's a whole new world with you.
Now I'm in a whole new world. Unbelievable sight. Do 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 do. Indescribable feel.
I hope you guys are singing, and I'm just like, oh, show's ending in 90 seconds. Oh, it's gonna wrap up as the song ends. Watch this.
A whole new world. Don't you dare close your eyes. Hold your breath. It gets better. I'm like a shooting star. I've come so far. I can't go back to where I used to be. With new horizons to pursue, I'll do them anywhere. There's time to spare. Let me share this whole new world with you.
See, guys, this is like letting go of the ego, right? Like, it's fun to just be able to sing when you suck at singing.
A whole new dream's a wondrous place for you and me.
I don't don't know if you guys could like hear it blasting onto my speakers. So, all right, guys, Blog Talk's going to end the show here on its own in about 30 seconds. So check out for the links on the Facebook page, and maybe I'll put up a revised version of me getting better at that song in the future. So, and Neurons to Nirvana, check it out at the Kickstarter. Please donate to that project and continue to share this episode on Facebook and YouTube. And 10 seconds left in the episode. I'll see you guys in the Hangout, youtube.com/SkullBabylon, facebook.com/SkullBabylon. Add me there, and we'll see you guys in the future. So, disconnecting now. Thanks again, guys. Glad we made the most out of it. And thanks again to Oliver. So, see you guys in the Hangout. Talk to you later. Bye. Wait. Can you hold on? Bling. See you guys.